Good evening, everyone. I want to start off by thanking all of you for still being here after an hour and a half. It's a really good thing. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Alan Ferdman. My wife, Pamela, right out there, and I moved here in 65. We've raised two boys, have five grandchildren, and along with my mother and some other relatives, we now have four generations living here in Santa Clarita. This is our home. This is where we intend to stay, and this is what we want to do. You know, throughout the campaign, you're going to hear all the candidates, and especially the incumbents, they're going to talk about how great it is to live in Santa Clarita. And they're going to talk about all the wonderful things that the city has done. And they're going to say that because it's absolutely true. But even with all that being said, we have a great many issues, a great many major issues that still plague us, that have been with us for a very, very long time. And that's why I'm running for city council. You, as our residents, deserve solutions and not celebrations of past achievements. You deserve a city that listens to your needs and acts in your best interest. And you have the opportunity on April the 8th to cast some ballots and make some changes. As the elected chairperson of the County Country Advisory Committee for the last 12 years, I've dedicated a lot of time to helping the city residents become informed about issues and helping them deal with city-related problems. I've been witness to our ever-increasing traffic, rising property taxes, mounting fees and charges, insufficient local jobs, lack of active parkland, the chloride tax, CMEX, the Burmite megamine contaminations, and issues with cut-through traffic, crime, and drugs. Some of our council members have been in office for way too long. Ms. West has been in office for 16 years, and McLean for 12. I bring to you expertise as a problem solver based on my 46-year career in aerospace as a project manager and software engineer at Litton Guidance and JPL. As your council member, I intend to provide you the fair and impartial representation that you all deserve. So I'm asking for you to vote for Alan Ferdman, and together, we will make a difference. I'm ready to answer any of the questions you may have. Woohoo!
Global warming.
You want me to answer that question?
Yes.
All right. The issue was, what about global warming and reducing our carbon footprint? And you know, in most cases, people talk about that from a standpoint of global warming, but I've had discussions with staff just based upon economics. Now, I don't know if you read the paper a couple of days ago and you saw in the news that the electric companies are going to the PUC to change their billing practices from how much electricity you use per month to what time of day you use your electricity. That's going to drastically increase your electric bills. When Southern California Edison decided to put in smart meters so they could monitor your electric use every 15 minutes, guess what this is coming to? When that happens, it's going to make the desirability of renewable energy and solar power much, much more attractive. And I think that's going to help solve the problem more than anything else right away. Uh-huh.
Of course, Al.
Okay.
Equal access.
All right, go ahead.
What do you feel are the most important environmental issues facing our community?
I believe that right now the most important and pressing issue is the Whitaker Burmite cleanup and the perchloride contamination that's getting into our well water. Because if we lose our well water, we lose everything. So right now, I've been to some of the interjurisdictional meetings, and I noticed the council never participates. There's never a schedule for completion. What we need is someone that's going to go down to that meeting every time it takes place and look for answers as to when we're going to be done, how we're going to get there, and make sure that it's happening. Because as of right now, all we ever hear every 4 to 5 years is it's going to be done in 4 to 5 years. So I think that's probably the most pressing and low-hanging fruit we could really go after. Didn't I just answer the global warming question?
One of them. One of them. There are lots, actually.
Okay.
But this one relates to the groundwater. If you're very interested in the groundwater, I'm sure you would be interested in keeping fracking out of Santa Clarita, I assume.
Well, in favor of protecting the groundwater. So I think fracking is an interesting subject because right now, as I understand it, that's going through a legislative review at the state level. And the state is going to come up with standards for fracking and for other methods of extracting natural gas and additional oil from their underground wells. So I think we need to keep a very careful watch on that because if we don't, what's going to happen is we'll get stuck with whatever the state says.
And there are no regulations in the state bill.
There is no regulation in this current state bill. But
lots
I understood
of reporting,
they were looking,
no regulations.
But I understand they were looking for regulations. And what we've got to do is we've got to try to influence those regulations so that it acts in our best interest.
So that would be important to you?
Yes. Oh, absolutely.
Thank you.
Absolutely. There's nothing more important than keeping the state at bay.
Todd Hoover from Castaic again.
Yes, sir.
Alan, what's your opinion on the disparity of benefits for city council members? And if you're elected, are you going to oppose that, or how do you think you'll deal with that?
The disparity?
Yeah, when the new incoming council members do not get the same benefits as the existing.
Well, that's true. I think what you should do is you should elect three new council members and save the city $40,000 a year. Yes, ma'am.
Lori Rivas. I believe the libraries are such a vital community service, and I'm a little bit concerned that some believe that balancing a budget and listening to the people and generically evaluating programs is enough to provide checks and balances to the library services and programs recommendations made by a private for-profit company. Do you see value in abdicating a generic city council equals the Board of Trustees, and creating a library board of trustees that includes educated, board-certified, independent librarians, and or hiring a city librarian as a city employee rather than someone beholden to LSSI to run our libraries? Thank you.
Lori, what I believe is honoring my commitments. And when the city council took over the library, which if someone's going to ask me that question, I'm going to be happy to deal with that one. But when they took over the library, they promised that in 1 year they would form either a board of library trustees or a library commission so that they would get the best information as how they could operate the library. And when that time occurred, they decided and they said, oh, I'm sorry, but you're not ready yet. So, yes, absolutely. I think what we need is, at a minimum, we need a library commission that has people in it that are educated and have extreme knowledge about how the library should operate, and they should be coming forth with those recommendations, and I believe City Council should go with them. So I think we should return the library ownership to the people through that commission and not through LSSI. Uh-oh. I know that request. Come on, I'm ready. Yes.
Hi, Alan. Cliff Stottinger from right here in Canyon Country. As a city councilman, what priority would you place on roadway management and improving traffic efficiencies here in our growing city?
Well, I think roadway management is important. I was hoping you were going to ask me the question about Via Princesa, but that's okay, too. That's all right, too. That's okay. Look, right down at City Hall, they have the supposed command center where they synchronize, watch traffic lights and watch traffic for however many hours of the day they do it. That command post is on the third floor, and even if you went on the third floor, you can't see it because there's a wall between you and them. So if it was me, I would put it on the first floor, turn it around and put glass, and so that you could see the 24 hours a day someone was looking at the traffic and actually making changes, right? Okay, there's no benefit for us to have a system that doesn't get used, okay? Right.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Boy, oh boy. Okay, here we go.
I'm back.
By the way, I'm from Brooklyn.
Yay, Brooklyn! Another Yankee transplant.
There you go.
You like that, huh? Yeah, I'm a Yankee transplant. Would you be in favor of changing the charter and how they elect mayor and council so that you don't have the rotation of the mayor among the council members, which almost clicks of, you know, collusion sometimes?
Absolutely. I think what the issue is that as the city grows, we're going to have to change with it. And change is always difficult because, you know, everybody wants to resist change. There was the resistance to change when we became a city, and as the city grows, there's going to have to be change that comes with it. So right now, I went and I looked. The population of the city has doubled since the city was formed. So when we talk about we want to have local control, I think we want to have control closer to our homes. And the way we do that is we do that with maybe at some point in time districts, at some point in time an elected mayor. And that elected mayor should be a full-time mayor that's responsible for the day-to-day operation of the city. And in that way, if we're not happy with that individual, we can vote them out. All right, right now, it's a much harder deal. So yes, I would be in favor of some changes to the charter and to our governmental system. Uh-huh. Now, I want you to notice that he comes up faster than everybody else.
He's like cringe when I come up.
All right, here we go.
I was wondering about the Santa Clarita Valley Sanitation District. I know that you've been very active in the chloride issue. I'm assuming that you would help support an effort at the council level to get these, to help get the chloride level limit lowered.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Go ahead. I wanted to ask you specifically, at what level do you feel like the sanitation district should go forward in trying to enforce the water softener issue? The one I'm really surprised by, and I think I was surprised when at one of the meetings when I talked to them about the saltwater pools. And while there's an ordinance against saltwater pools in Santa Clarita, it's very vague. And if you go down and ask, you know, our salt water, they will permit a salt water pool in the building and safety department at Santa Clarita Valley. In Santa Clarita, they won't ask you whether it is a salt water pool or not. Right. And they will permit it. And I was wondering, at what level do you feel like the city should go forward and enforce the Santa Clarita Valley Sanitation District, the water softeners and saltwater pools?
Okay, well, you know, you kind of asked me six questions, but I'm going to give you my favorite answer. My favorite answer. You know what? When it came to the issue of chloride, four years ago, and they set the rates for the last 4 years, we all went down to City Hall, and they said, we're going to fight this thing. We're going to make sure that we don't get stuck with what we've got, right? And 4 years went by, and they did absolutely nothing. And so when we finally got hit with this thing, we are now on the hook to spend $350 million to build and operate a water treatment plant to remove chloride from wastewater so we can throw the water away in the river, okay, over that next 20 years. That's what that bill comes to for that 20-year period is $350 million. And if that doesn't bother you, I don't know what should, because it's not going to benefit us. And by the way, the farmers in Ventura never got water over 100 milligrams per liter, because as the water goes through down the river and passes the Piru Creek, it gets blended with Piru Creek water, and it is below 100 milligrams per liter today. This is a scam. We're stuck with the bill, and we should be doing something about it now.
But would you support more intrusive efforts by the sanitation district to enforce the water softeners and the saltwater pool?
Well,
I mean, what difference does it make if you have a saltwater pool ordinance that is not being endorsed?
Well, saltwater pools is one issue, and water softeners are another, because self-regenerating water softeners add to the chloride level. If you think a $350 million bill was bad, if we hadn't gotten rid of the water softeners, we'd have a $500 million bill. So I think it was absolutely wrong the way they did it. I think they posed it to us as if they were going to solve the problem, and they didn't, okay? Saltwater pools, on the other hand, are something where the water stays in the pool, and when it gets drained, it typically doesn't go in the sewer system anyway. So it's a different issue, and we ought to go look at it as a different issue. It's a stormwater issue. And stormwater, by the way, when someone says, watch out, things are coming, stormwater is coming. Because my time's going to run out for your question, but at the last council meeting when Ms. McLean said, everything we do today complies with all the state regulations, not true. There was just a new stormwater. The N4 stormwater permit was just passed. That's part of what the county was playing with their Clean Water, Clean Beaches Act, okay? And that says we've got to reduce the chloride in stormwater before we dump it in the river. So wait for that one. If we don't act and just wait, you'll see it on your property tax bill in the very near future.
Ellen Minerva Williams from Castaic. We know you to be a very serious, kick-ass individual, and we know you do your homework. We're very much concerned that there's 13 people running for office. We appreciate Canyon Country Advisory Committee taking the time where we can all sit here and hear your information as well as being able to look at it on video so we can play the information back. What other two individuals would you recommend that we take seriously for this office when we know you will take those two with you?
Wow, now you want to see me dance? I knew that question was coming. And I'll tell you what, I don't think it's a fair question to ask right now, and I don't think it's a fair thing to answer right now, because we've got to see those 13 people. You really need to come here and listen to all 13 people and make some decisions about who is going to do the best for you. And I don't know all those 13 people, so I need to do some research now myself, especially since the 13th one just showed up today. Anybody else? Oh, come on.
I got to ask that question.
Okay.
Alan, would you be in favor of a new senior center?
A new senior center?
Yes.
I would be in favor of more senior center facilities all around the valley. You know, right now, there's one in Newhall. Well, you know what? Seniors especially, they don't like to drive a lot, especially as they get older. We should have senior facilities in Saugus. We should have a senior facility in Valencia. We should have a senior facility in Canyon Country. They should all be linked together, and they should work together. That goes for community centers as well. I mean, right now, the only permanent community center we have is in Newhall. We should have a permanent community center in each quadrant of the city, and we need to go service our community that way. That's part of it, especially when we start talking about public safety and the idea of providing services for our children and young adults. We need those kind of things all around the city, so absolutely. We need to find a way to do that. And if I didn't have 30 seconds, I would tell you how we could have done some of that. Yeah, someone want to ask a question?
Just real quickly, could you talk a little bit about public transportation and seniors? Would you be in favor of getting a common definition for seniors so that we're talking about the same thing? So that seniors right now need to be, what, 60 years old to ride the bus? For free?
Okay.
Would you be in favor of lowering that to 50 years old so that it corresponds to the definition by the Association of Retired People?
Well, you know, it's an interesting concept, but someone's got to pay for the bus. I mean, at some point, we can't let, you know, we've got to decide where the activities are. I don't know if we get some funding for seniors, some grant funding, some federal funding, some state funding. That's a good thing that I got to do some research on, Minerva, and we got to find out. But in essence, public transportation has got to pay for itself. And in order for it to pay for itself, people have to use it, people have to pay for it. So I'm not necessarily ready to just snap and say we should reduce the fees or increase the fees, but I think it's something we really need to look at. Sure.
Thank you.
All right. Uh-oh.
I understand that there's an issue where there will be more mental health inclusive in the Affordable Care Act. In doing so, that would also entail more availability for mental health and mental illness situations. Olive View, I understand, is one of those facilities that's here locally, or the closest that we have locally. And in order for a lot of people from this Santa Clarita Valley area to get to Olive View, it requires a letter to be written that we would like to open up the transportation, and there's supposed to be money sitting aside for that purpose. Would that be something you would be advocating for or investigating?
Well, certainly, if there's money set aside to do it, we ought to do it. I mean, health care is a very important issue. We need another hospital on this side of the valley for sure. We need a transitional care unit. We need probably more than one, one by the Newhall Hospital and one here. If people with suffer from mental illness need to have a place where they can be treated. So absolutely, especially if there is funding available to go have something done for them, absolutely, we should go look for it. Yes, Rena.
Rena Newhall, Valencia, 46-year resident. I care about the community, and when I see buses that are totally empty and late at night or at different times of the day, I wonder why we can't get smaller vehicles that they have at the senior center and they have at the Sunrise Assisted Living. Wouldn't that be more economical?
Amen.
And I'm
amen. I think what we just said was that public transportation has to pay for itself. And you certainly, we don't want to just say, well, we got a lot of big buses here if no one's riding them, right? We want to have them be as representative of the use. And more than likely, if the buses are smaller, they'd probably be less costly to run. So I think it's a concern when you see that. I think buses right now get most of its use by school kids when they go to school in the morning, when they come home in the afternoon. And it's got to be economical and it's got to pay for itself. That's all I can say. Okay, so now I get to wrap up. Okay.
Do you
have
another question on the floor? I do. I'll be very quick. The homeless shelter, can that be expanded so it's not just for the few months but throughout the year so we don't have people living in the riverbed and stuff like that?
Okay, I was on the homeless shelter, the LA County Homeless Shelter Task Force. Which determined the three locations. It included the Drayton Street location, and 3 years after we did that, they recalled the Homeless Shelter Task Force back together to discuss the generation of a permanent shelter overlay zone, and we applied the same criteria that we used to site the shelter, and there currently is on the books in Santa Clarita an overlay zone where permanent shelters can be permitted by right, which means that, you know, if you are able to put one in, it has to happen. And the issue of making it happen is whether or not individuals who are concerned with that are able to raise the funding to make it happen. But the city itself has provided for it. That, by the way, is a state law that requires them to do that, and they have provided that part. Yes. Okay. Right, now faster? Okay. Let me start out by expressing my appreciation for my friends at the Canyon Country Advisory Committee for hosting this event and the Moose Lodge for providing the venue. Giving everybody the opportunity to be aware of city issues is a very important civic activity, and they should really be commended. But most of all, I would like to thank all of you for taking the time to be here all 2 hours and be informed about what your city candidates have and what their positions are. My intent tonight was to raise your awareness about some of the challenges facing Santa Clarita. You might ponder some of them, like the increasing traffic next time you're headed to work during rush hour. But better yet, what you should remember if you live close to this area is that just a few years ago, your city council, with Marcia and Lorraine on it, voted to build a trash sorting facility just up the street, up Sierra Highway, just on the other side of Golden Valley Road. And that facility was going to receive trash from all over the valley, dump it on the ground, sort it, and then truck the final output somewhere else. Operating that facility would have resulted in an additional 600 truck trips a day on Sierra Highway, bringing with it more traffic congestion, noise, filth, and pollution. Fortunately, the alarm was sounded by Green Mountain residents Joe and Kathy Thompson, and on that next Monday, right here in this room, over 100 residents met with me and the Thompsons to establish a game plan on how to get that decision changed. In short, over 120 local residents attended the next three city council meetings and spoke out against the plan. We prevailed. The plan to build a facility on Sierra Highway in Golden Valley was scuttled, and more appropriate locations were later found. Why am I telling you this? I'm telling it to you to emphasize the point that all of us, every one of us, can have a big part in shaping Santa Clarita's future. When someone tells you you can't fight City Hall, they're only right if you try to do it by yourself. Right. I believe that Santa Clarita deserves a brighter future, a future that acknowledges and all of its residents and not just a chosen few. I believe that we are best served when the public is informed, have a welcoming place to be heard, can expect a fair hearing on every issue, is always given honest and accurate answers when they ask questions. If you want to make that kind of a vision a reality, I am asking you to join our team. Vote Alan Ferdman, and together we will make a difference. By the way, I have materials on the back table. And if you want lawn signs, see me right after the...
Alan, your website.
Electalanferdman.com.